Okay, so here's an example of a problem where we're told to use Stokes theorem to evaluate a line, or I usually call them curve integrals, and we're given the curve and the vector field. So in Calc 3, when you're told to use Stokes theorem, that usually means they want you to evaluate it one of two ways. You'll either be given a curve integral or line integral and a curve, and you have to solve it as a surface, or you'll be given a surface and they want you to evaluate it as a curve. Basically, what that means is you want to use the equation for Stokes theorem, which is, let's just rewrite the given part. We're given the curve integral, and we're going to say that that equals the surface of the curl of the vector field dot ds. And this ds, this would be bold, like this r here, because it's directional. So we can rewrite that again as the curl of the vector field dot a normal vector, which we have to evaluate. And then it's just ds. So we have to find all these parts and evaluate this because we're given the curve. But in other cases, you might be given a surface. You want to evaluate this part. Okay, so the curve that we're given is pretty simple. It's just a circle when c equals 7. So if we say that that's 7, imagine that's a circle. It's just a curve where r equals 3. So that's a curve, but it's easy to imagine it as a surface, like we will later, where instead of r always equaling 3, it can vary from 0 to 3, and theta would still be 0 to 2 pi. So we'll get back to that later. One of the first things that we can do is basically just go through and find each individual part. So we can find the curl of the vector field. That equation is del crossed with the vector field. So that's going to give us a matrix, ijk, and then del is partial x, partial y, partial z. So to simplify the vector field in the matrix, we can just put each part of the vector field as components. So we can say that this part is P, this part is Q, and this part is R, just to simplify it when we write it out. All right, that's going to give us I is partial R, partial y, minus partial Q, partial z minus the j component. The j component is partial r, partial z minus partial p, partial z plus the k component, which will give us partial q, partial x minus partial p, partial y. Okay, so looking at the vector field, hold on, let me get that in the screen. There, hopefully you guys can see that. That's going to equal partial r with respect to y, that gives us 0, minus partial q with respect to z. I'm looking here to see how to take the partial derivatives. The partial of q with respect to z, there's no z here, so that's 0 plus, that's going to give us 6x. So minus 6x, then we have minus j, partial r, partial x, 0 again. Partial p with respect to z, that's going to give us minus, so plus 6y plus the k component. Partial q with respect to x, that's going to be 0 plus 6z. Partial p with respect to y, that again, that's going to be plus 6z. Okay, so scroll down. Okay, so simplifying that, we're going to get negative 6x, and then distribute this negative, so it's going to be negative 6y and 12z. So that's the curl of the vector field, and we're going to dot that with a normal vector. All right, so I'll show you how to do that. NdS, and then this is going to be integrated over a surface. We can already imagine that it's going to be just a z component, because, well, I drew that poorly, but the circle is flat. We're told that it goes counterclockwise, so it goes, imagine it travels this direction, the curve. Using the right-hand rule, we should expect a normal vector that just goes straight up, because there's no angle to this curve or surface. So I'll show you now how to calculate the normal vector. Well, we want to rewrite the curve as a surface, and because it's a circle, we want to switch to polar coordinates and then take a cross product to find the normal vector. So we have to use the formula that says when you take the cross product of two lines on the plane, it'll give you orthogonal vector. So let me just show you what I mean. If you remember, we said that r is going to go from 0 to 3 and theta will still be 0 to 2 pi. R and theta are our new variables, so we can rewrite x just as a circle in polar coordinates, so that's going to be r sine theta, y equals r cosine theta, and z will still equal to 7. So rewriting the curve using theta and r, or r and theta, we're going to have r sine theta, r cosine theta, and 7. Now, to find the normal vector, we can just say the normal vector is the cross product of u and v, let's say. But in this case, it's going to be our two variables, our theta and r. Okay, and knowing the right-hand rule, we're expecting the normal vector to be in a positive direction. We might do this cross product and find that we get a negative value. And if we do, that means that it should have been r crossed with r theta. But let's just try r of theta crossed with rr first and see if that gives us a positive value or not. Okay, so let's take the partial derivative of this new curve that has been reparameterized using polar coordinates, and let's take the partial derivative with respect to theta. So we have to do it for each component. The partial derivative of r sine theta is going to be r cosine theta. For r cosine theta, it's going to be negative r sine theta. And for 7, it's going to be 0. For r with and a partial derivative with respect to r, that's just going to give us r sine theta, cosine theta, and 0 again. Okay, so with those two equations, let's now take the cross product. Alright, let me just try to make room here. Okay, so the normal vector, well, let me not rewrite it, but that's just going to equal another matrix. So we have I, J, K, and R partial theta is R cosine theta, negative R sine theta, 0, that's going to be sine theta, cosine theta, 0. Okay, so we do the cross product one more time. That's going to give us 0 minus 0 minus j, which again will give us 0 minus 0. We expected this because we already know from our graph that we should get just a k component. So the k component is r cosine squared theta minus a negative r sine squared theta. If we pull out the r, so we have 0, 0, pull out the r, that's going to be cosine squared plus sine squared. That's a trig identity, so that's just going to be 1. So our r component is 0, 0, r, and it did end up being positive, so we did the correct order of the cross product. Again, if you did r partial r crossed with r partial theta, you might have gotten a negative, in which case you just want to check the right-hand rule and have made it a positive. Okay, but since it's positive, we know that that's correct. Okay, so now we can take the dot product of our curl of the vector field with the normal vector. So the curl of the vector field that we got was negative 6x, negative 6y, and 12z. However, since we reparameterized it into polar coordinates, we want to do the same thing with the vector field. So that's going to be negative 6 r cosine theta, negative 6 r sine theta, and 12, and z equals 7. So do that, and then 0, 0, and r is still r. So that dot product is going to give us 0 plus 0 plus 84 r, and then we're going to take that as a double integral. This is going to be the r integrand ranges, and this will be the theta. So we already said from before, if we consider it a surface, r is going to go from 0 to 3, and the theta is going to go from 0 to 2 pi, so we could rewrite ds as dr d theta. Okay, so when we integrate with respect to r first, that's just going to give us r squared over 2. Whoops, that's an ugly 2. Okay, so that simplifies to 42, and that's going to be from 0 to 3. 3 squared is 9, so that's going to be 42 times 9. And then that whole thing will just be times 2 pi since there's no theta variable. When you simplify all that, that's going to give you 756 pi, and that's your final answer.